Just to kind of give you some, remember, Ruth gives up her culture, her people, and her language because of her love for God and his people. And I ask you guys a question. You know, have you found your Boaz?
Yep.
You know, y'all remember that? Have you found your Boaz?
Yes.
You know? So, man, let's dive into this. It's going to be good. Before I read the remaining of Ruth, we are in chapter 3. And I went to, thank you.
Yep.
I went to like verse 10. I'm going to back up and start in chapter 3, and we're going to read it. But before we go there, first thing we need to do is I need to open up some things, because where we're going in the book of Ruth, so you can understand about the taking off of the shoe and all of this stuff, you know, what happens is I'm going to read some stuff to you, and you can open your Bibles and go to Deuteronomy. Chapter 25, verse 5 through 10. I'm going to read that, and I'm going to tie in another story, because it all fits in with this book, okay? And it's really amazing. So we're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 5 and 10. Let's go there first. And things are going to begin to click to you guys when we get into the book of Ruth and, you know, I start reading. So, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you, Father, for who you are. We thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you're never changing. Lord, we thank you, Father, that we're your children. And Father, just we love you, Father. Help us to be like Ruth, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. Okay, here in Deuteronomy is just Moses before he dies. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 25, verse 5 through 10. Deuteronomy only consists of 30 days of Moses' life. They're about to cross over into the Promised Land. He's re-going over all of these laws and reminding them, you know, of all these things. So here, this is what is said. All right, verse 5. If a brethren dwell together and one of them die and have no children, the wife of the dead shall not marry without unto a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go in unto her and take her to him to wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother unto her. So the brother goes in to raise up seed for the brother. Okay? So that means when he takes her to wife, you know, he doesn't name the child what he wants. That child doesn't actually, is physically for his brother. And he takes on the brother's name. You understand that? Watch this. And it shall be that the firstborn which she shall beareth shall succeed in the name of the brother which is dead, that his name be not put out of Israel. And if a man like not to take his brother's wife, then let his brother's wife go up unto the gate of the elders. Wow, go to the gate. And say, my husband's brother refused to raise up unto his brother a name in Israel. He will not perform the duty of my husband's brother. Then the elders of the city shall call him and speak unto him. And if he stand to it and say, I like not to take her, meaning I don't want to raise up seed for my brother. Wow. Okay. Then shall his brother's wife come unto him in the presence of the elders and take off his shoe from his foot and spit in his face and shall answer and say, so shall it be done unto that man that will not build up his brother's house. Wow. Right? Verse 10. And his name shall be called in Israel the house of him that hath his shoe loosed. Man, you know, a shoe is a support. That's what it is, right? You have no shoes, you have no support under your feet, right? So he's going to be known as one who is not a supporter, that won't raise up seed for his brethren, that's more worried about his own self than others, than his brother, okay? When men strive together one with another, wait, that's it, I'm going to stop right there. All right, now let's go to Genesis chapter 38, because this is going to tie in. Genesis 38, you're going to see what I'm talking about. Absolutely. This, you're going to see how this stuff ties in. It is absolutely amazing. It says, Genesis chapter 38. This is, we're going to start reading in verse 1. Watch this. And it came to pass at that time that Judah had went down from his brethren and turned into a certain Adullamite, whose name was Ahira. Now, Adullamite, his name means Ra, the son God has given, and whose name was Hira. Hira means nobility. So he turned into a friend's house, a man of nobility, okay? And it's important where they got their names from, and you're going to see why. And Judah saw that a daughter of a certain Canaanite. And I remember that they wasn't supposed to take, you know, the Canaanite women. You know, when you go into the land, don't sleep with the foreign women, right? Remember Ruth, you know, her husband, Mahalon, had married. She was a Moabite. That was a no-no. Wasn't supposed to do it. They were forbidden to marry into the other culture. Now, and Judah saw a daughter there of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shuhah, which means prosperity. And he took her and went into her, and she conceived and bare a son and called his name Ir. Ir's name means watching. And she conceived again and bore a son, and she called his name Onan, which means strong. And she yet again bare and bore a son and called his name Shelah, which means sprout. And he was at it's Hezib, because the CH is huh. So at Hezib, where she bore him. So she bore him, and Hezib means deceitful. She bore him, the last born, in a place of deceitfulness. Now watch how it all ties in. Okay? And Judah took a wife for Ir, his firstborn son, whose name was Tamar, which means palm tree. Okay? Ir's name means palm tree, and it's derived from the word Jericho. Wow. Right? And Ir, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord slew him, just like he took out Jericho. So Ir was wicked, right? And Judah said unto Onan, his son, go into thy brother's wife, and marry her, and raise up seed for thy brother. Now Onan, his name is strong, right? And Onan knew that the seed should not be his. And it came to pass when he went into his brother's wife that he spilled his seed on the ground, lest that he should give seed to his brother. Here he is again. You know, Onan. Think about this. Onan don't want to raise up seed for his brother as well, right? But yet he wants to go in to his brother's wife and fulfill the desires of the flesh. So he is, you know, all about self, right? And the thing which he did displeased the Lord, wherefore the Lord slew him also. Then said Judah to Tamar, Tamar means palm tree, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow at thy father's house till Shelah, which means sprout or root, his youngest son, be grown. For he said, lest peradventure he die also, as his brethren did. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. And in the process of time, the daughter of Shuhah, Judah's wife, died. So now Judah's wife died. Now remember, Jesus is of the line of the tribe of Judah, right? This is Jesus come through this line. In the process of time, the daughter of Shuhah, Judah's wife, died, and Judah was comforted and went into his sheep shear to Timnath. And his friend Ahira, in Ahira the Adullamite. And it was told Tamar, saying, Behold, thy father-in-law goeth up to Timnath to shear the sheep. And she put forth her widow garments off of her, and covered her with a veil, and wrapped herself, and set it in an open place. So here, you know, she takes off her clothes that shows she's a widow, and then she puts a veil on her face and everything, and she goes and sits in a certain place, which is by the way of Timnath, for she saw that Shelah was grown, the youngest son, and she said, and she was not given him to wife. Remember where Shelah was born? Remember? He was born in Chezib or Hezib, Chezib, which is a place of deceitfulness, right? So what does she do here? She puts off her clothes and she deceives Judah, right? Watch. When Judah saw her, he thought that she had been a harlot because she had covered her face. And he turned into the, by the way, to go into, and he said, I pray thee, let me come into thee, for he knew not that she was the daughter-in-law. And she said, What wilt thou give me that thou mayest come into me? And he said, I will send thee a kid from the flock. And she said, Wilt thou give me a pledge till or you send it? And he said, What pledge shall I give thee? And she said, Give me thy signet and thy bracelets and thy staff. His signet is his emblem, the lion of the tribe of Judah, his staff that his generations are rode on, and his bracelets. That's what she wants. She wants his lineage. Right, that's what she's looking for. She wants to be at his feet, but he won't take her. So Judah should have gave her the youngest son, Shuha, but he never, right? So, and he gave it to her, and he came into her, and she conceived by him. And she arose and went away, and laid by her the veil from her, and put on the garments of widowhood. And Judah sent the kid by the hand of his friend, the Adullamite, to receive his pledge from the woman, and he found her not. Then he asked the men at that place, saying, Where is the harlot that was openly by the wayside? And they said, There was no harlot in this place. And he returned to Judah and said, I cannot find her. And also the men of that place said, There is no harlot in this place. And Judah said, Let her take it to her, lest we be ashamed. Behold, I sent this kid, and thou shalt not find her. And it came to pass about 3 months after that, it was told to Judah, saying, Tamar, thy daughter-in-law, hath played the harlot. And also, behold, she is with child by whoredom. And Judah said, Bring her forth and let her be burnt. Wow. Yeah. Golly. I mean, they serious business. When she was brought forth, she sent to her father-in-law, saying, By the man whose these are, I am with child. And she said, Discern, I pray thee, whose are these, the signet, the bracelets, and the staff. And Judah acknowledged them and said, She hath been more righteous than I. Why? Why? Because she wanted to raise up seed for her husband. She was more concerned about raising up seed for her husband than his own father was worried about. Wow. And she went by any means to get it, to do it. Right? And that's why Judah said she has been more righteous than me. Because he wasn't worried about the son, but she was. She was worried about raising up seed for the dead. That was her number one concern. Because guess what? If it was just about raising up seed, she could have went and married anybody she wanted because she was freed.
Right.
But she was more worried about raising up seed for ear, right, than any other thing. And it came to pass in that time of her travail that both twins were in her womb. And it came to pass when she travailed that one put forth his hand, and the midwife took and bound upon his hand a scarlet thread, saying, This came first. And when it came to pass, as he drew back his hand back within in, that behold, his brother came out. And she said, How hast thou broken forth? This breach be upon thee. Therefore his name was Phares. And afterwards came out his brother that had the scarlet thread upon his hand, and his name was called Zerah. Now, she has twins. Twins are in the womb, and twins are always symbolic to the two Adams in the Bible. Twins are always symbolic. The first one caused the breach. Remember, Adam caused the breach. And that's why Phares' name means breach. And Zerah, the second born, remember, he was first. He put his hand out. She tied the scarlet thread. The scarlet thread is about Jesus, right? The blood trail. He pulled his hand back in, right? Because Jesus was before anything, before creation. He created the first Adam, right? He was before creation. But we didn't get to see him first. We just got to see his handiwork.
Right.
And what he created, right? We seen the hand. We seen the hand write the law at Mount Sinai. We seen the hand on the wall. Who was that? That was God. We seen Jesus said, this woman is caught in adultery in the very act. What do you say we do to her? And he showed him his finger, his hand. The first one represents God, represents Jesus Christ, represents, you know, anyway. The second one afterward came out his brother, verse 30, and a scarlet thread was upon his hand, and his name was Zerah, which means shining or flashing of light or the dawning of a new day. Wow, the twins. So Cain and Abel, pictures of the two Adams, right? Who else was twins in the Bible?
Come. Esau
and Jacob. Wow, one was red and ruddy. And the other one put on a skin. Right? Esau. I mean, Jacob. Remember Adam, Adam, his name means red. Adam, taken from the red ground. Right? Yeah. Jesus was the red man. Right? So, the first set of twins, we see Cain and Abel. Right? Cain, he was like his father, a tiller of the ground. The first Adam, Abel, was a shepherd like Jesus. Right? You know, the righteous blood of Abel, the righteous blood of Jesus. The next set of twins we see is these set right here, Zerah and Phares and Zerah, right? One causes a breach and one brings forth a new day. When Jesus came, he split time. The dawning of a new time, a new era, a new season, right? The next set of twins we see is Jacob and Esau. Esau was red and hairy, red and hairy, Adam, from the red ground. And Jacob, whose name means sub-planner, which means to go before. Why? Watch. Because Jesus was actually before Adam was. He was actually before. Now watch. Remember, Esau sold his birthright for red food, red porridge. We think it's by deceitfulness that he inherited what he inherited, but it was not. You think it was, but it was not. It was a picture of Christ. How can we say that? Because Esau gave his birthright away. He sold it and would have never gave it to his brother who rightfully owned it because he despised it. And he sold it for food. What did Adam sell his birthright for? Food.
Yeah.
You with me? Wow. So how did Jacob get the kingdom from his brother Esau? How did he get the blessing? Well, very simple. He slipped into a skin. Oh. Whoa. Wow. Adam sold a birthright. You ready for this one? How did Jesus get the kingdom back from Satan? He slipped in a skin. He slipped in the skin. Wow. You with me? You with me? You got that, Court? All right. So now that's the next set of twins you see. Uh-oh. So we've seen the twins in the Bible. The Bible says that Eve conceived and bore Cain and bore again Abel. She didn't conceive again. Twins. Twins in the Bible always represent the two Adams, right? So here it is. Now watch how amazing. You see this name Phares and Zerah, right? You're going to see this in the book of Ruth. That's why I took you here. The story of Judah going sleep with Tamar, you know, his daughter-in-law and everything that happened, the story is about Er and Onan. And it's about the stories about raising up seed for your brother. Right? I sat at the feet of my daddy when he played music, and he wasn't raising up seed for himself. My mom and my dad taught me about Jesus Christ. They were raising up seed not to carry on the name of Bobby Schubert, but to carry on the name of Jesus Christ. That's what we're supposed to do. Jesus died. And you're supposed to raise up spiritual and physical children under the name of Christians, raising up seed for the dead, but he's alive again.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Don't be worried about raising up your name, building your kingdom. It's about building his kingdom. And I tell you what, it was a pain in the butt when my mom wouldn't let me, you know, when I was in school and wouldn't let me. I was a drummer. Man, I was the second seat in a band as a drummer. Second seat. Mama said, you ain't going to the parades. And if I ever catch you playing on that drum set, anything that's not a god, I'll put my foot through the heads. I'll bang the heads out of it. That's what my mama told me. You play for the world, you won't have no drums. I hated that. I couldn't go here and I couldn't go there. She was training me to do what it was I was supposed to do. I hated it. I hated it. And man, not till I got older did I understand. But she was raising up seed for Jesus Christ and not for Satan.
Yes, amen.
And my mama would grab me and put me up against the wall like this by my neck on Sunday when it was time to go to church. Come here, mama. Come here. Come here. Let me show you what I went through when I was a kid.
I don't like them days.
Remember you used to do me when I'd cause trouble? And I want you to actually do what you did me when I was a kid when I was on Sunday. It's time to go to church, right? And you know, now I'm gonna cause what I'm gonna do is now watch this.
I cried a lot them days.
Be gentle with me. Watch this. I knew I didn't want to go to church. So what I'd do is I'd cause a disturbance between my mom and my dad. My dad was a little bit more lenient, right? But mama was, you know, mama said, you going to church, and this is what she would do me when I'd be causing all kind of, you know, here it is. I'm a kid like this, and I'm causing all kind of trouble. What would you do?
You was a little taller than that.
Right, hold on. Oh, yeah, I took
you
a behind beating at 17.
Yeah. At 17,
I took a behind beating. Go ahead. Yeah. So.
We're going to church. And if you cause trouble between me and Daddy, it's going to be me and you. You understand me?
Yes, ma'am. She hasn't done that to me in 25 years. Now I call her up. You're coming to church, right?
Hey, would you like this to wipe the sweat beads off your
And let me tell you something. I got to do the same thing to my... I got to do the same thing to my kids.
Daddy wouldn't hear me.
Right, it had to be real low like that, too, because if Daddy heard what was going on, oh, Patsy, leave him alone. But she was determined. I'd be in church like this, and this ain't no lie. I'd be like this, sitting in the seat like this, or getting my eye closed, and bang! I almost fall out the chair. Man, it was serious times. All right. Serious times. Let me tell you something. What?
She said she didn't get put up against walls. She got the finger and you take a step forward.
Right. Right. All right. So, let's now, you see the importance of raising up seed. Now, let's go to Ruth. Man, you guys are in for a ride. Let me tell you something, you know, man. All right. So, if you guys, listen, I just want to give you a heads up. I encourage you, if you haven't, Brother Carl, I want to ask you, was you able to load up the other things yet?
The last 2 weeks?
Yeah, no.
They just out, just did.
Oh, okay. So they, so the new ones are uploaded. If you haven't had a chance to look at Ruth 1 and 2 yet, you know, please go look at them because this is going to tie everything together for you guys. All right, let's start. Naomi seeks redemption for Ruth, beginning at chapter 3. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, "My daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee?" That means marriage. You know, shall I not seek that you get married, that it may be well with thee? And now, is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast, used with? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. And we went over and showed how this is actually the night before, actually it was the beginning of Pentecost because it started in the evening. So they're winnowing wheat on Pentecost, right?
Yeah.
All right. "Wash thyself therefore and anoint thee and put thy garment upon thee and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known to the man until he has done eating and drinking." Now watch this. "And it shall be when he lieth down that thou shalt mark the place where he lies, and thou shalt go in and uncover his feet and lay down." Now, coming to the feet, we went over it last week. She was asking for marriage, okay? She was asking for a covering. That's what she was asking for. So number one, the first thing she did was she veiled herself, and then she marked where he lay down on the threshing floor, which was actually Pentecost, the night, you know, because it began at 6 o'clock in the evening. And that's right. And let's see, it says, and she marked a place where he lay down, and then Naomi, who is a picture of the law, the old covenant, was teaching her how to come unto Boaz, the Redeemer, okay? So, because she was a Gentile, so this is a Gentile being married in, being taken in. And it says, "And it shall be, when thou lie down, that thou shalt mark the place where thou shalt lie, and thou shalt go in and uncover his feet and lay down." So she was asking for a covering. She was asking, when she uncovered his feet, if he would raise up seed for her husband. That's what he's asking. That's what she's asking, right? "And he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And he said unto her, all that thou sayest unto me, I will do." Simply going in there and pulling back the covers off of his feet, revealing his foot, his feet. She was asking him to sleep with her, to become her husband, to raise up seed for Mahalon. For her brother. For her husband. But watch what happens. Amazing. Right? He says, "All that you have asked me, I will do." And she went down to the floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry. Did I pass something up? No, his heart was merry. He went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn. This is talking about the end times, when we're going to be married to Jesus Christ. And she comes softly and uncovered his feet and laid down. And it came to pass at midnight. Wow. Matthew chapter 25. Remember the parable of the 10 virgins? And a sound went out at midnight for the bridegroom and the groom. Right? Here it is at midnight. The bride is coming to the groom's feet. That it says, "And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman laid at his feet." Why was he afraid? What was he doing there? He was protecting his harvest.
Right.
and he was all of a sudden got startled. He thought maybe somebody was coming in, you know, and it scared him at first. And then when he looked, he turned himself, and behold, a woman was at his feet. That's why we come to the foot of the cross. We're asking Jesus Christ to be our covering. Jesus was teaching about that, right? And he said, "Who art thou?" Because it's dark, it's midnight. I'm sorry, I don't have street lights over there. Right? It's midnight. "Who art thou?" And she answered, "I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman." Wow, we're going to get see what that near kinsman is too. And he said, "Blessed be thou." And he said, "Blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast showed more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning. Inasmuch as thou followest not young men, whether poor or rich." Wow, right? You remember with Tamar, she was free from the law. She could have went where she wanted. She was free too. Right? But she's more concerned, not about her. She was concerned about her mother-in-law. "You've showed more kindness now by doing what you're doing, coming to the feet." She could have married anybody else she wanted. Man, I'm going to show you something that's absolutely mind-blowing. She could have married another guy. But it won't be raising up seed for her husband. So this near kinsman is really, really near. We're going to find out how near. He said, "Thou followest not young men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman." Listen, we're the bride of Christ. We need to be known for our virtuousness.
Right.
Not being in the world, taking part in the things of the world.
Right.
Yeah. Drugging and drinking and doing these things. And then, you know, on Sunday at church, worshiping the Lord.
Right.
Yeah. Right?
Right.
You can't be in another man's field. You can't have the world and God too. It's either one or the other. That's why the Lord says, rich or poor, right? I mean, why he says, either hot or you're cold. If you're lukewarm, I'll spit you out of my mouth. Wow. "And now it is true that I am a near kinsman. Howbeit, there is a kinsman nearer than I." Wow. "Tarry this night, and it shall be in the morning." In the morning is Pentecost. It actually began that night at 6 o'clock. "Tarry this morning." Watch this. "Tarry this night, and it shall be in the morning that if he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman," well, let him do the kinsman's part. That means he's going to have to raise up seed. He's going to have to come unto you and marry you, right? "But if he will not do the part of a kinsman to thee, then I will do the part of a kinsman to thee. As the Lord liveth, lie down unto morning." So you see, here it is, you know, she's with him now, right? But there ain't nothing happening. Ain't nothing happening yet. "And she lay at his feet until morning, and she rose up before one could know another." So it's still dark, right? "And he said, let it not be known that a woman came into the floor," because they wasn't supposed to come to the threshing floor. It's not time yet. Okay? The women would come in the morning. Right? Now watch this. "Also he said, bring the veil that thou hast upon thee." So she was veiled. Tamar was veiled. Remember? "And hold it." So now she's holding the veil. Watch this. You guys are going to be blown away. "And when he held it, he measured 6 measures of barley and laid it on her. And she went into the city." You know what that is? 6 measures is the measure of the man. And she laid on him his seed. "All that you're asking me to do, I will impregnate you." He gave her 6 measures. 6 is the number of man. And he poured it into her. Wow. Wow. Watch. Watch what he says, though. I know, I see you smiling over there. You with me?
I'm with you.
Watch this. And when she came to her, watch this. And when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, "Who art thou?" Because it's still dark. "My daughter, who art thou, my daughter?" And she told her all that the man had done to her. Now listen to what he says. And she said, "These 6 measures of barley gave he me, for he said," watch, "for he said to me, go not empty unto thy mother-in-law." The seed that was put on her, 6 measures poured into her. When he poured it into her, she had it on her. It looked like she was pregnant, but she was carrying seed not for her, for her mother-in-law. She was carrying a man.
Yes. Praise God.
Whoa. For, what's his name? The father's name? What was the father's name?
Elkanah.
Elkanah. Wait.
Her husband.
What was her husband's name again?
Elon.
No, the husband of
Emlak.
Boaz was saying, "I'm going to give you what you asked me." When she was lying down on a threshing floor, "I'm going to give you what you asked of me. I'm going to give you a son. But before I give you your son, I'm going to give you something to carry for your mother-in-law." Wow. Man. Why? Now remember, the kinsman has got to do the work of the Redeemer, but she's old. And the Redeemer's work was to marry, oh my Lord, oh my Lord, to marry the brother's wife. The kinsman's Redeemer, when the brother died, the brother was to raise up seed for that brother. But the problem is, she's not able to carry seed. She's too old. But the marriage still takes place. And Ruth carries the baby for her mother, who is now married to, what was his name? Emlak.
What was Emlak's brother?
Hold on. Wow. Boaz is Emlak's brother. Is literally and physically Emlak's brother. And I'm going to prove it to you.
So who was the one that was closer to me?
There was 3 brothers.
So he was the younger brother.
That's right.
He was the first one.
See, he was the youngest.
Yeah.
Remember the youngest in the story with Tamar was supposed to raise up seed?
Yeah.
Right? There was 3 brothers. Emlak was a brother. Boaz is a brother. And you want to know who the other brother's name was? Jason. Jason, the twin columns in the front of Solomon's temple, the house of God. Wow. Wait, we ain't started yet. Watch this. Let's go deeper. Now watch this. This is not only Pentecost. This is not only happening on Pentecost. And I'm going to prove to you beyond the shadow of a doubt that Boaz is literally and physically Emlak's brother. Listen to this. And she said, verse 17, "These 6 measures of barley gave he me. For he said to me, go not empty unto thy mother-in-law." Boaz is going to be the one who raises up seed for his dead brother through Ruth. Watch this. Then said she, "Sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall. For the man will not be in rest," right? Day of Pentecost, right? "Until he have finished this thing this day." Now watch. "Then went Boaz up to the gate." Now he went up. Pentecost. They went in the upper room. What gate did they go in? Mount Moriah. They up on a mountain, right? That's where Pentecost came down, right? And watch. "And sat him down there. And behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spake came by. Unto whom he said, Ho!" Now, ho is mentioned four times in the Hebrew Strong in the Bible. And it could say, you know, "Hey, come over here." But the way it's pronounced, the way it's said right here, they don't know what it actually means. It could mean brother. He could have said, now you look at it in the Hebrew Strong's Concordance. Now, this ain't the proof that it's his brother. But this word ho, where it says, is a general passerby, "Hey man, could you come over here?" Three times, out of the four times, three times it's mentioned like that. But this one time could actually mean, "Hey brother, man, come over here, I need to talk to you." That's what it could mean. And that's what it means. I'm gonna prove it to you. Watch this. "Then went Boaz up to the gate and sat him down there. Behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spoke came by, unto whom he said, Ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here. And he turned aside and sat down." Watch this. "And he took 10 men." Now, why 10 men? This is Pentecost. He took 10 men because 10 represents the law. And the law was given on Pentecost. But this is this day that's happened, it's a very, not only is it Pentecost, but it's a very special day. Watch this. He says, "And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, Sit ye down here. And they sat down. And he said unto the kinsmen, Naomi, that is come again, out of the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land," right, "which was our brother Amlek's." What did you say? Our brother. "Which was our brother Amlek's." Now, brother, let's check this out. Let's see what it means. Hebrew Strong's Concordance. It says, in Ruth 4:3, a parcel of land which was our brother Amlek was sold. So Boaz is telling him, now this could generally mean, just generally, a brother, a near kinsman, or anything like that. But it just so happens to be that this word brother, Rachia, can I say Rachia? Rachia. This word brother, Rachia, well, it's the Hebrew word 251, which means, ah, brother. Literally, my brother.
What's the Hebrew again?
Hebrew, it's the Hebrew 251. It's A-H. It's A-H. Watch this. Man, this is crazy. So, brother, and the Hebrew is A-H, with a line over it like that. Ah, my brother. Ah, finally, I got to see my brother. He's waiting in the gate for his brother. And it means literally brother. Watch this. It says, first meaning of the word literally means brother. But it could be, by an extension, family, kinsmen, or relatives. So the same word is used. But here, it literally means brother. So the first key off note, the first one that this word, aged, is taken from, so we know if it's his physical brother or not, comes from the Hebrew 278. This was 251. Right? Is that what I said?
Yes.
This one was 251. Which could actually be by extension, but ah actually means brother, but by extension it could mean someone in your family, right? But the first, it's keyed off to 278, and the 278 is the word, it's ehi. E-H-I. So this is where this word is directly taken from, which physically means my brother. Physically. His physical brother. You know what else it means? My Lord. The whole meaning of this word. This word is used when your physical brother dies. It means my brother, open quotes, is now exalted. To lift up the name of your brother. This is Boaz's brother. Wow. You can check that out. Look, Hebrew Strong's Concordance. That's where you get it from. It gets good. Watch this. Man. Trey, watch this. I know I wore the first one out. Oh, you bought me this one too? Oh, this one here? Yeah, the first one. Anyway. So, and he said, verse 3, and he said unto the kinsmen, Naomi that has come home again out of the country of Moab selleth a parcel of land, which is our brother Elimelech's. Hold on a second. Wait a second. She sold land. And watch what he says. And I thought to advise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou will redeem it, redeem it. This is not only Pentecost. This is Jubilee. Redeeming the land back unto the brothers. Isn't it kind of funny, man, that Jubilee, 50 is Jubilee, right? After 2,000 years, Jubilees, 120 Jubilees, the Lord comes to redeem the earth, right? Watch this. Then Boaz said, verse 4, and I thought to advise thee, brother, saying, and I just put that there. Hey, brother, I thought to advise thee before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me that I may know. For there is none to redeem it beside thee. And I am after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. So he tells his brother, brother, you know, our brother Elimelech's dead. The wife sold the land. Will you redeem it? Will you raise up seed for your brother? Because if you don't want to raise up seed for your brother, so that brother you won't be disgraced and your shoe is taken off and Naomi spit in your face. Yeah. Brother, I'll do it. So you see, he's set free from having his shoe loose and being spit in the face and being known as a man with a loose shoe who wouldn't raise up seed for the brother. Yeah. And when he knew that Boaz would redeem it, watch what happens. He says, watch this. Then said Boaz, then verse 5, then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it. Wait, hold on. Let me go back. Verse 4. And I thought to advise thee, saying, buy it from before the inhabitants and before the elders of the people. He's in a gate now, right? Same place where did what's his name go in the gate? Remember that? Tamar went to the gate. Remember? Where was Jesus crucified? At the gate. It's all a picture of him. If thou will redeem it, redeem it. But if thou will not redeem it, then tell me that I may know. For there is none to redeem it besides thee, and I am after thee. And he said, I'll redeem it. That's what he said. I'll redeem it. No problem. You see, because Naomi is a Jew. But watch this. Then said Boaz, what day that thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, because Imlek had a son, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. So, here it is. He's saying he would raise up seed for Naomi. I don't know how he could possibly do that because she was old. You understand?
Yeah.
He said he'd redeem it. But okay, you're going to redeem her and raise up seed for her, but you now have to redeem, you know, you have to raise up seed for Mahalon through Ruth. That means, watch, my wife said this, it blew me away. My wife said this. This really, and she don't know it till today. The day that you raise up seed for Naomi, you also have to raise up seed for Imlek's son, Mahalon. Who married a Moabitess. Wait. The Gentile. The law forbade. He represents the law, and the law forbade them to marry into the foreign women. And listen to what he says. Listen to what he says. No way will I do that and give up my inheritance. For him to marry a Gentile would be forfeiting his inheritance. He was more concerned about his inheritance than raising up seed for his brother. You see, he didn't have a problem with his brother, with his direct physical brother, Imlek, raising up seed for him. The problem came in to be able to save the seed of his son, Imlek, who defiled himself with a Moabite Gentile. He said, no way, I'm not going to do it. But what he says is, since Boaz had already told him, if you won't redeem it, I will. That was his way out.
Right.
Because the law can't redeem. The law cannot redeem.
Right.
Watch this. Oh, God. So he says, verse 5, then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up name the name of the dead upon his inheritance. And the kinsman said, his brother, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar, forfeit my own inheritance. Wow. You see, grace and law can't coexist. They can't coexist together. I'm going to show you what I'm talking about with that. Watch this. He says, redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. The law cannot redeem you. It can only show you your faults.
Right.
He was bound under the law. He couldn't get out from under it. But he said, oh brother, if you're willing to forfeit, you know, forfeit your inheritance, well then, do it. Because you see, he was more concerned about his brother than himself. Jesus was more concerned about us than himself. He was willing to lay his life down and be marred. Wow. To be exposed at the gate for you and me, to purchase us so that we can raise up seed for him. Watch this. Now, this was the manner in former time, I read it to you, in Israel, concerning redeeming and concerning changing. For to confirm all things, a man plucked off his shoe and gave it to his neighbor. And this was the testimony in Israel. The testimony, the gospel of peace, your shoes. Put on the gospel of peace, the testimony of Jesus Christ. This is what people need to see. What shoes are you walking in? The gospel of peace or your own?
Amen.
When you're walking in his shoes, you're raising up his kingdom. So he drew off his shoe, and Boaz said unto the elders, therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it from thee, buy it for thee. So he drew off his shoe, and Boaz said to the elders and unto all the people, you are my witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Imlek's and all that was Chilhon's and Mahalon's of the hand of Naomi. So right there he bought. Now check this out. My Imlek's name means my God is king. He bought all Boaz, who was a picture of Jesus Christ. Imlek's name means my God is king. Chilhon means wasting away, and Mahalon means sickness. So the king, my God, who is king, bore our sicknesses. Right? Didn't it say that?
Right.
At the gate? All of our wasting away and thing that we did, he purchased that with his blood. He purchased all of the sicknesses of Mahalon and the wasted time and the wasted life of Chilhon. He purchased it at the gate. And he received the shoe from Imlek, and that was his proof that he owned it. He owned it because he held the shoe. That was his. He'd go in his house and put it up. This is proof. This was Imlek's shoe right here. This was the near kinsman's shoe. I mean, I purchased this. Here's the proof. The feet. And Boaz said unto the elders and unto all the people, you are my witnesses this day that I have bought all that that is Imlek's and Ha'alon and Mahalon's out of the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess. This is Pentecost. It's all redeemed. Naomi is redeemed. Ruth is redeemed. The dead is redeemed on Pentecost. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahalon, have I purchased to be my wife. Wow, Jesus married the Gentile bride to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. Watch this. Moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahalon, I have purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. Who's dead? Imlek. It was Imlek's inheritance that Naomi sold. Boaz is saying, I'm going to raise seed unto my brother through Ruth, Imlek. And they all knew it. Watch. That the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate. He is the brother of Imlek. Whose seed is he more concerned about raising? Is it Mahalon, his son? No. It's Imlek, his brother. I'm a raised seed through my brother. Though Naomi is old, my first son, I'm raising it up for the name of my brother. Oh, when I you're going to see how God blesses. You're going to, wow.
I know.
How God blesses Ruth.
Yep.
Ruth has three sons and two daughters. Wait a second. Mary had three sons and two daughters. What did you say? Well, I said that Joseph, Mary's husband, raised up seed for God. Amen. Before himself. What did you say? He could have put her away. She was impregnated by the Holy Spirit and raised him for God. He was more concerned about the seed of God than his own inheritance. Than his own inheritance. Because his inheritance wasn't of the earth. But it was of heaven.
Amen.
And his inheritance, like yours and mine, is in Jesus Christ. And he understood that. So, with Mary being pregnant, can you imagine? Can you imagine coming home and your wife pregnant? She said the Holy Spirit overshadowed her? You don't think there was a war in Joseph? That woman is lying, son. And that's why God, by his mercy and grace, sent an angel and said, Joseph, Yosef, whose name means my God will add.
Wow.
The seed that the woman is carrying is mine. Will you father him?
Amen.
And I'll bless you. It's about carrying his seed. It's not about carrying my seed and building my kingdom. Man, wait, watch this. You are my witnesses this day. Deuteronomy 25:26. Let me see what this is. I got it noted. Deuteronomy 20. Oh, that just goes back. The key off verse for that. Verse 6. And it shall come to pass that the firstborn which she beareth. Oh, I'm sorry. The key verse for this verse that I just told you. That moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahalon, I purchased to wife, to raise up the name of the dead, which is my brother, upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among the brethren, and from the gate of his place. You are my witnesses this day. The key verse for that is Deuteronomy 25:6, which is, and it shall be that the firstborn which shall beareth shall succeed in the name of his brother, which is dead, that his name shall not be cut off out of Israel. Verse 11. And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, we are witnesses. Lord, listen, watch this. Listen what they say to Ruth. Lord, make the woman that is come unto the house like Rachel. Wow. And like Leah, right? Rachel and Leah. Who was married to Rachel and Leah?
Jacob.
Wow. We connected back to the guy who slipped into the skin. Huh? Right? Watch. Which two did build the house of Israel and did worthily and Bethlehem. That's another word for Bethlehem. Ephrata. And to be famous in Bethlehem. Oh, did I tell you that Jesus was from Bethlehem? Oh, did I tell you that Boaz was from Bethlehem? Oh, did I tell you that Judah was from Bethlehem, Judah? Wow, all three stories the same? Wow, are you serious? I'm serious. Watch this. And let thy house be like the house of who? Phares. Breaking out. That's what it means. Breaking out a breach. Chloe, you was blessed in a messianic church. And what did they do? You remember? They brought you forth. And they took the tallit, the veil, and she got underneath. She was like 12 years old. Watch. I'm talking about. My God. At about 12 years old, you was brought and placed underneath a tallit, the law. 613 knots represent the 613 laws of the Old Covenant. And this was the scripture they blessed you with. May you be like Rachel and Leah. And bring forth children, burst forth children, not unto Chloe, but unto Jesus Christ. And that's why you name your children Abel and Noah. To do what? To raise up name for Jesus. Wow! I'm naming my children this because I want to raise up. I want people to think when they think of Noah, they think of what Noah did. Rest in the ark. Rest was sought. The rest was sought for Ruth. Ruth, the mother said, shall I not seek rest? Shall I not seek marriage for you? Rest. Noah's name means rest. Abel, the righteous blood of Abel, Avel, that's his name. It means Abel, breath of life. You're raising up seed for Jesus. You gave them to him. And that's yours. It's to bring him glory.
Yes.
That's what we do, whether physically or spiritually. We raise up seed for him. But you have to go through the threshing floor to get a deposit of that seed. And if you're not willing to go to the threshing floor, no seed. Threshing floor gets its word from what they thresh it with, a tribune. They thresh the wheat and the barley with a tribune, where we get the word tribulation. Because it's in tribulation that God raises up the seed, the house of God. Remember Egypt? Do you remember Egypt?
Yeah.
They poured it on them, but they began to multiply.
Yeah.
You ready for the big one? You ready for the big one? Watch this. We know. Let me read this. So Boaz took Ruth. Watch this. So Boaz took Ruth. And she was his wife. And when he went in unto her, the Lord gave her conception. Wow. Wow. She was, I would think you would call, she was barren. She was barren. Man, barren women in the Bible. Wow. She was married. She had no kids. You remember other barren women? Remember Jacob? Rachel was barren. Wow. Abraham and Sarah? Sarah was barren. Wow. Remember all of these barren women in the Bible produce children who are a picture of Jesus Christ. What are you talking about? Oh, remember Manoah? Remember Samson? She was barren. Right? Who else was barren? Elizabeth was barren. That's right, whose name means covenant. John the Baptist, his mother. She was barren. Right? Hannah. Ooh. Ooh. What did you say?
Hannah.
Hannah. Wow. Wow. How many knows who the first son of Ruth was? Who did Ruth give birth to? Obed. Obed. His name means servant. Remember a guy by the name of Obed-Edom who served in the house of God? Obed-Edom. Red. Wow, you mean to tell me that Obed's red? That's a connection to Jesus Christ. Right? Are you with me? Jesus formed a man out of the red ground. He was the red man that hung on the horse. I mean, hung on the cross. On the cross. David. On the cross. David. Remember, he was the king. Picture of Christ. He was red and ruddy. What?
Yeah.
That's right. Remember? Yeah. Remember all the red men in the Bible? Wow. So we know who Ruth's first son was, right? Ruth had three sons and two daughters, just like Mary. Wow. You know who Ruth's first daughter was? Hannah. Mm. Man.
Mm. Hannah?
Hannah.
The Hannah.
The Hannah. Who said and cried at the house of God, who was barren like her mother and all the other ones praying at the temple. Open my womb and the first son you give me, I'll give him away to you. She learned from her mother. The firstborn son is not yours. Belongs to the king. Where does the king sit? In the temple. Jason and Boaz. Here we go. It's all connected.
Wow.
Watch this. Watch. And the women said unto Naomi, verse 14, blessed be the Lord which has not left thee this day without a redeemer. Wow. And the women, no, I'm going to go up to 13. So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife. And when he went into her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. And the women, watch. Watch what the women does. They were at the gate. They know what's going on. They know what's happening right now with Ruth and what this son is going to be. They know it's not Ruth's. They telling us it's not. Watch. And the woman said unto Naomi, blessed be the Lord which has not let thee. Blessed be who? Blessed be Ruth? No. Blessed be Naomi. For the Lord has not left thee this day without a kinsman, a redeemer. A redeemer, a kinsman, someone who will raise up seed for you, that his name may be famous in Israel. And he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life. Wow. Wow. The kinsman, Boaz, is going to be a restorer of her life. Watch. And a nourisher of thine old age. It's all talking about Naomi.
Yeah.
For thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons hath borne him. Wow. Watch. And Naomi took the child and laid it in her bosom and became nurse to it. Watch. Her son. She took the child. It's hers. Wow. Watch this. And the women, she don't name it. And the women, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, there is a son born to Naomi. There's a son born to Naomi. She's rejoicing now. She has seed.
Wow.
She received it spiritually. That's why physical seed and spiritual seed goes together. We raise them up physically and spiritually. That son became, Ruth was just a womb to carry the seed from Boaz, who was the brother of Imlek. The same seed was placed in a holding thing until it was ripe and ready to come out. And when it came out, here's my son. Not Naomi's. Never, ever will that son be known to be, be Ruth. Never will that son be known to be Ruth's. Never.
Never.
You see the importance of raising up seed. Not for you and me, but for Jesus Christ. Watch this. And the woman, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, This is a son born to Naomi. And they called his name a servant. Obed. He is the father of David. What did you say? Wow! He's the father of David. The father of Jesse. The father of David, which is Christ's line. She not only gives birth to Jesse, which now we know she gave birth to Obed. She gave birth to Jesse as well as two sons and gave birth to Hannah. What? You see, the hard thing is following the women's lineage because it's not there. It's the father's. I'm going to show you. Man, you got to look. Watch this. You could find out who their mother's names were. You just got to do a little digging. And it says, and the woman, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, there's a son born to Naomi, and they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the generations of Phares. Wow. Phares begat, right? Hezron. And Hezron begat Ram. And Ram, which means high and exalted, begat Amminadab. And Amminadab begat Nation. And Nation begat Solomon. Salmon. No, wait, hold on a second now. Hold on a second. We got Salmon. S-A-L-M-O-N. Salmon. You know who Salmon was? And Salmon begat Boaz. Salmon begat Boaz. Who was Boaz's mother? The harlot. Rahab.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Who played the harlot? Tamar. From that same line, every woman. What did Joseph think Mary did? She thought he played the, that she thought that Joseph thought that she played the harlot. Tamar played the harlot, right? All of these. Wow. Now you know Boaz's father's name, Salmon, who married. Remember going into wow, watch this. Watch the connection. So absolutely mind-blowing. Tamar's name means palm tree. Jericho. Connected. Who's at Jericho? Rahab. Rahab's at Jericho. Who Salmon marries a harlot. A Jew marries a Gentile harlot. Wow, like Boaz married a Gentile. Like Jesus marries a Gentile. What did you say? Like Judah married the Canaanite Gentile. My God, son, only God the Father in heaven, the high and exalted one, could do something like this. Amen. Just like the harlot Israel played the harlot on God the Father. Just like the church today plays the harlot. I'm going to close with this. But guess what? There is a Redeemer.
Yes. Yeah.
Listen to this. Verse 20. And Nahshon begat Salmon. And Salmon begat Boaz. And Boaz begat Obed. And Obed begat Jesse. And Jesse begat David. Absolutely. All the way to the throne. David. Right? You know who's not in that? Saul's not in that lineage. Kingdom was taken away from him. Watch this. I close with this. Oh, thank you, Father. The near kinsman, sum it up. The near kinsman.
Wow.
The near kinsman did not want to give up his own inheritance by marrying an unclean Gentile. It was prohibited by God according to the law. Ruth was the mother of Hannah, 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1 through 20. And Samuel's name, she gave birth to a son, Eli. Hannah went to the temple and prayed and prayed and prayed. Eli had two wicked sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Eli's name, Emlek, Eli, my God. She's crying, he thinks she's drunk.
Yeah.
Thinking she's drunk, right? She's at the temple. He says, look, whatever it is you're asking of the Lord, may he grant it unto you. No, no, my Lord. He tells her, Eli says, get out of here, old drunk woman.
Yeah.
Lord, I'm not drunk. You know, I'm not drunk. She tells Eli, I'm just barren and I want to have a son. Yeah. Well, may the Lord grant to you what it is that you want. What did you say? She's at the temple. I bet you it was on Pentecost. And she said, the first one, if it's true, I'll give him back to God. And when she had him, she brought him to the temple.
Right.
And guess what his name is? Samuel. You know what Samuel's name means? Samuel's name means the name of God. Hebrew Strong's Concordance, straight to it, Samuel means she gave him the name of God. Not her name. Not her name. Not who she was married to's name. She gave him to God. Ruth was the mother of Hannah, who gave birth to 3 sons and 2 daughters. On the first, whose name was Samuel, in which she did as her mother Ruth did and gave her son away to God the Father. Wow. Raising up seed for another. Is not this what God has called us to do? To raise up seed for another. To raise up seed for Jesus, who was dead, but he is alive again.
Amen.
We're all the bride of Christ. In Ruth chapter 4, verse 3, a parcel of land which was our brother Imlek. Brother in the Hebrew 2:51 is ah. It means literally it was his brother. So Boaz and Imlek were brothers. Ruth raises up seed. Her daughter is Hannah. Hannah gives her son to God at the temple. Right here. That temple is right behind me. Jason and Boaz. Solomon's temple. Right? And guess who? The great-great-grandmother. The great-great-granddaughter. The great-great-granddaughter of Ruth is Mary. The mother of Jesus. Mary raises up seed for God. Joseph raises up Jesus for the house of God, not thinking of his own self, but giving up his own inheritance. He gained the inheritance of God the Father. Are you carrying the seed of the Father? John said something that was absolutely amazing, and maybe it'll make sense to you now, because it really opened some stuff up for me. John the Baptist. Check out this. Now think about this. Jesus comes to John. And what does John say? I'm not even worthy to unloose your shoes. I'm not worthy to raise up seed on your behalf. John represented the law, and the law was saying it can't raise the seed up. I'm not even worthy to unloose your shoe. Wow. John represented the law, and the law cannot raise up grace. They cannot coexist together. The law demands justice. Grace demands forgiveness. In Luke 3:16 and in Matthew chapter 3, verse 9 and 10 is where John says, I'm not worthy to unloose your shoe. It's not about raising up seed, our children, physically. I mean, it's about raising up seed. It's about raising up seed, both spiritually and physically, for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why it's important that we be impregnated by the Word of God, which is seed, so that we can bring forth spiritual and physical children. You understand?
Yes.
Can I say something wrong?
Yes.
I really feel like I need to say this, but...
Hold on 1 second. Okay. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for everything, Lord. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, that everybody in here, Lord, whoever hears it, Father,
yes,
Lord, would give their life away,
yes,
for you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen.